Arranging the vocals for our worship songs and figuring out when and what our singers are going to sing is just as important to the dynamics of a song as figuring out when the drums are going to come in or how the guitar and the keyboard parts are going to complement one another. And we recently talked about how we use gang vocals to add power, and out of that discussion sparked some great follow-up questions about how we arrange our vocal parts that I wanted to answer for you now. Hi, I'm Dave Dolphin at practicalworshipblog.com, sharing ideas, tips, and practical advice for the everyday worship leader. And on this channel, we have weekly videos that help you lead a worship band and be a leader of people. So if you haven't already, consider subscribing so you don't miss the next video. Recently, we released a video on the topic of gang vocals, how we can have up to 7 singers all singing together in the bigger sections of a song, like the chorus or the bridge, and how we only have one person assigned to sing harmony for the entire weekend. Everyone else is singing melody. If you haven't seen that video, I'll link it up right over here and in the description down below. When I posted that video to Facebook, Brenton Collier asked a bunch of follow-up questions about how we choose which singer will sing harmony for the weekend. Do we use gang vocals in verse sections? And when would I recommend branching into 3-part harmony? And these were such good questions that instead of typing up the responses, I made a quick video. I originally just posted that video to Facebook, but I also wanted to share it with all of you here on YouTube. So here is that response video.
These are awesome questions, Brent, and I appreciate you mentioning these. One, he asks, do female singers ever have a hard time singing the melody on male-led songs because of the key? And the answer is yes. At times, there are you know, maybe a song that we're singing that the ladies, there's just certain notes that they don't have. The thing about gang vocals is that I'm not necessarily making sure that all of the singers sound awesome when they sing. That's not what the power is. The power is just this collective group of people singing. If you pull back those layers, not all those vocal parts are going to sound awesome. I personally have a really low voice. I have a baritone voice, and I can hit D above middle C in my chest voice, and everything else above that, I have to go into falsetto. So some of these songs, I'm flipping into my falsetto. And what I tell the ladies, you know, a lot of times they're in the basement. They're singing in a lower part of their voice than they're used to. And I just say, hey, do the best that you can. Sing it with all the gusto. And if there's a note that's too low, then just don't sing it. Or if it's too high, then don't sing it. Again, the power doesn't come from the individual voices. It's the whole, the collection of all the voices together, that one big choir sound. That's what make gang vocals sound really good. The second question he asked, how do you choose which of the singers is the harmonist for that week? In our situation, it's actually kind of easy because I have one person that I generally use. Although I do have other people that can sing harmony, this one person just has a voice that cuts through the mix. Sometimes it's just not a matter of can you sing harmony. I have a lot of people that can sing harmony. But do you have a timbre in your voice that can cut through all of those gang vocals? So I've got a few people that I use, but there is one that I lean on pretty heavily. Third question was, do you ever have gang vocals on verse sections? Because I mentioned in the video that I primarily do it in choruses and bridges. Yes, there are times that it sounds really good. This weekend, in fact, we're doing the song Resurrecting by Elevation Worship. And in that third verse where the band comes in, we actually have all the singers come in. I don't know. I thought about this. I don't know if I have, like, you know, if this happens, then therefore I will do this. It's just felt good. It felt good to the arrangement to have all the singers come in at that moment. So we've been known to do that. We also do the Jeremy Riddle version of This Is Amazing Grace. We don't do the Phil Wickham version. And there's a part where in the middle of verse 2 where we bring in all the singers. It just feels really good to do that. So yeah, there are times to do it. But not all the time. The fourth question that Brenton asked is, when would you say is a good time to branch into 3-part vocal? One, if you are nodding to something that is traditional. Sometimes we might do a hymn and it's just the pad and the singers. Almost all the time, we're going to go 3-part harmony on that. And we're going to nod to the fact that it is traditional and that 3-part harmony makes it sound like that. The thing about 3-part harmony is that it is really pretty. And I know why singers love to do it. It's that when you listen to modern music, whether it be, you know, a Justin Timberlake or Justin Bieber on the radio or Taylor Swift, or you listen to modern worship from Chris Tomlin or Bethel or Hillsong or whatever, there's not a lot of harmony. It's not part of the style. So one of the reasons why we don't do it is because it stylistically, it doesn't seem to fit. But there are some moments where it is really pretty to shine through. Again, I mentioned that Jeremy Riddle song, that This Is Amazing Grace. When we bring the singers in on verse two, halfway through that, we actually do three-part harmony because the band is down. There's not much to the arrangement. It's not really big yet. And so it is kind of a neat thing to let the singers really shine through. And we, in the moment, like what makes that arrangement really neat at that moment of the song is the three-part harmony. That kind of gets the light shown on it a little bit. And then when we go back into the chorus, we drop back to just having one harmony voice.
Well, here at Practical Worship, we love sharing ideas and tips and practical advice for the everyday worship leader with videos just like this one. If you haven't already, consider subscribing to the channel. And for more great advice, you can check it out in the form of a small little ebook called 20 Things I Wish I Knew 20 Years Ago. It's the advice that I've learned over the last 20 years of doing music ministry. And you can download it right now for free at practicalworshipblog.com.